So good morning, all of you. So I promise to end in time so that we are not late for lunch. So before I begin, I should thank Amita for inviting me for this conference. So she has not only shown great generosity, but also a lot of patience with me. And to give a major clarification, this is not a high energy physics talk. This is a talk on, as Professor Kao put it, high energy plasma physics, HEPP, not an HEP talk. So what we are going to do is to try to understand the physics behind the laser plasma acceleration, what I call as the tabletop accelerators, from a different viewpoint. So I arrived here on the 9th, and for 2 days, I had a good injection, good dose of introduction and exposure to PIC simulations, particle in cell simulations. So what we are going to do is sort of complementary to that. And I hope to convey the message that there are perhaps many ways of looking at the same phenomena, and therefore several ways of appreciating the physics behind this phenomena. My collaborators are Ravindra Kumar, who was a PhD student, and Vinod Kishan, who was in IIRRI. I am particularly grateful to Vinod Kishan because this whole work was triggered because she asked me a question about Compton scattering in the medium. She was working on Compton scattering in the medium. And as we started working on that problem, we realized that it had something to do with laser plasma acceleration. So let us get to physics. So we have already been exposed to a fairly long introduction to both high energy physics, and all of you are plasma physicists. But still, for the sake of completion and to hit the stage, let me go through it very briefly. The most important thing that we have to remember is that the physics of high intensity fields is drastically different from the physics of low intensity fields. We see that in nonlinear optics, and we see that in high energy physics. So being in high energy physics, I'll start with the classic example of photon splitting in very high magnetic fields, which would not be allowed in the absence of a magnetic field, close to the pulsars, for example, when the magnetic field is of the order of 10 to the power of 12 Tesla. Or we have spontaneous pair production, which is the Schwinger mechanism, where you need electric fields of the order of 10 to the power of 18 volts per meter. And Vinod had a lot to say about that. We have quark-gluon plasma, where we need energy densities of the order of 2 to 10 GeV per Fermi cubed. And as I said, we have nonlinear optical phenomena. For example, you have production of ultraviolet laser, EIT, electromagnetically induced transparency, et cetera, et cetera. The last one is not actually very different from the previous ones, because here we have a medium explicitly in place, the physical medium, whereas in all the other examples, vacuum acts as a medium. It's only in the lowest order when we do a calculation that all our equations behave in a linear fashion. The minute I switch on higher order perturbations, the nonlinear effects start taking place because it is not additive in the fields anymore. Fields need not be super large because medium also plays a very important role. So this is the message that we have from whatever we have learned in the last 40, 50 years. So what we want to do is to look at laser plasma interaction also from that perspective. So what we want to do is to have a combination of high intensity with medium. Whereas in quantum field theory, or for example, when you look at the production mechanism of quarks and gluons in QGP, there is no medium. You have to invoke very complicated non-perturbative phenomena because of which quarks and gluons will be produced. But here, we have a medium, and we should exploit that. So we are going to ask a number of questions. Is it possible to simulate high intensity physics with moderate intensity beam interact with the medium? In fact, that is exactly what laser plasma interaction does. Then the second question that we can ask is it possible to produce ultra strong electric or magnetic fields in the medium? Again, that is what laser plasma interaction does. It produces such strong fields that it is almost impossible to produce them over even many times that length scale in free space. That is the reason why our accelerators are so gigantic, and what are the possible applications. So all these are illustrated with what I call as tabletop accelerators. They are indeed tabletop accelerators because the most powerful of them is about a meter long. Okay. So we have heard already from Rajaji and Vinod that conventional accelerators are very, very big. So we have LSE at CERN, which has a circumference of 27 kilometers. Stanford has this linear accelerators, which is 3.5 kilometer long, probably the world's straightest object, because the beam has to move without any deviation. The medium energy accelerators at JFL, for example, is about 1.4 kilometer long, and low energy accelerators are about 10 to 50, if you are not interested in them. So this gives us an idea of the engineering problems and the physics problems that are involved with accelerators. And accelerators being our microscopes in nuclear, atomic, molecular, and particle physics, we can't do without them. So we are building heavier and heavier machines. And even for moderately low energies, we find that we need to build big accelerators. So accelerators have many uses. And normally we only think of particle and nuclear physics, maybe atomic molecular, when people do deep inelastic scattering there, when they look at, you know, very deep levels in atoms. But they have other uses like material science, medicine, radiochemistry, analytical chemistry, and other areas. So probably, if you remember that these are required and we need to build more efficient accelerators without demanding the very high quality, high beam quality, which is required in particle physics. Suppose we don't demand that. We don't require that kind of monoenergicity, or we don't require that kind of a collimation. Then it should be possible. Maybe it is possible to build accelerators through a different principle, because bulk, size, cost, all of them matter when it comes to applications. So such an out-of-the-box approach was due to two pioneers, Kajima and Dawson. Now, these slides, I will go through them very carefully. It is actually for the high-energy physicists who are sitting here. So there are many, many varieties of these laser plasma accelerators. You have the laser wake field accelerator, which Kajima and Dawson proposed in 1979. So they also proposed plasma beat wake field accelerator in the same paper, because they realized that to produce very high accelerating gradients is not very easy. Then subsequently, we have resonant laser plasma accelerator, self-polarized laser wake field accelerator, plasma wake field accelerator, so on and so forth. So in other words, what we call as laser plasma accelerator comes in many, many avatars. Is that okay? Many, many incarnations. And the underlying physics is roughly the same, but it exploits different kind of phenomena. And the credit goes to these two pioneers who completely thought out of the box. In fact, their argument was that if the major problem in acceleration is the dielectric breakdown, why should we not look at a system which has already dielectrically broken down? And that is a plasma. So, and then of course, they substantiated that intuition with very strong simulations. I believe they introduced PIC model in their paper. I'm not very sure of that. And that's what they did. Technologically, of course, we needed advancements. You needed the chirped pulse amplification technology, which essentially delivers intense, high-power, ultra-short laser pulses. I'm making these statements not only to give a brief introduction, but also to point out at the end as to what we have taken into account and what we have not taken into account. Because it is very impossible, it is very important for us to take stock of what exactly we have achieved at the end of a piece of work. Otherwise, one might tend to exaggerate one's own contribution. So some of the highlights are the acceleration gradient can be of the order of 100 GeV per meter, which was otherwise completely unimaginable. So over a few centimeters, it can be accelerated to, let us say, energy of 100 MeV. Total charge collected is a few nanocoulombs, so it is not too small. Pulse shaping allows high collimation of about 3 to 5 milliradians. So when we speak of a beam, one is collimation, another is monoenergicity. There is a high monochromaticity. The energy, delta E by E, is of the order of 0.01 to 0.1. Unfortunately, I don't have a slide on what the corresponding parameters in accelerators, high energy physics accelerators are. But I believe that collimation is much, much more, and the intensity is much more. So at this stage, we should not probably immediately start dreaming of using this straight away to build a high energy physics accelerator, that would require much more work. Okay. So we need some parameters in order to appreciate what the physics behind is. So this at this scale essentially. Peak amplitude of the normalized vector potential. Basically, you are looking at the field energy against the rest mass energy. That should, it is related to peak laser and weak laser power. Sorry, that hand should not be there. We need a high value. Laser intensities will be of the order of 10 to the power of 18 watts per centimeter squared, which compact laser sources produce. And as I told you, production of very strong gradients in free space is very, very difficult, and hence the enormity of conventional accelerator size. Basically, the way a conventional accelerator acts is to give a gentle push every time, in every round. And the particle keeps on moving round. Again, it comes, it gets another gentle push. If you give too violent a push, other phenomena may take place. Or you are not able to produce the strong fields in any case. In high energy, heavy ion collision, certainly the pushes are very, very gentle because you want the nucleus to be intact. The binding energy, you know, is of the order of 7 MeV or some such thing. And if the whole beam has to move at 4 TeV, it should not break down. So it is very, very gentle push. And these are huge machines, but that is not what is happening in the laser plasma accelerator. So this is a kind of figure where you send a drive pulse and then it goes through this one. Probably the next one is a better one. This is for a GeV acceleration. So I forgot to write down the credit. I think this is from one of the papers of Joshi, UCLA group, where you see there is an electron pulse which comes, goes through the plasma. It is accelerated. There is a spectromagnetic magnet. So that is not the very important thing. The length scales are important. 85 centimeter, 218, 86. And this is of the range of 100 centimeter. So you can conventionally place that here. And you have got a beautiful accelerator. I believe the latest is that they are able to produce beams of to about 48 GeV. So this is an enormous number. Probably a beam of something one third or half of the energy was sent. And a 48 GeV electron beam is something that they are able to produce through a plasma. And obviously, this phenomenon must be a very rich laboratory to explore physics from all points of view. We should be teaching our students of these things because these are the most exciting things. Okay. The conventional explanation is to say that the electrons get scattered either by a plasmon or by the wake field. So how do we understand that? But before we do that, I should show some experimental results. So this is an experiment from a very famous paper of Malkas group, Faure et al. In Nature, where the energy is, the yield is plotted against the energy density. And please note that there is a nice monochromaticity here around about 150 MeV or whatever. The acceleration has taken place over a distance of about a centimeter or a fraction of so. There are also a lot of other resonances which are seen here. But the most important thing is that there is a nice yield. So here is a blow up of the same thing after removing all the background. You see that there is a quite a nice collimation that is taking place. So this, as I told you, was achieved because of the technological advances, and that is quite remarkable. So now let us come to the physics. So in any problem like this, we have a dual approach, two kinds of approach. One is what we call fundamental. So imagine reducing all of chemistry to physics. So we would not have bond length, we would not have hydrogen bond, nothing which chemists so nicely and so conveniently use, because physics doesn't use any of them. So you start with the first principles. So if you can do an analytic calculation, you do that, which of course is impossible. Therefore, you do the simulation. The analog of that in high energy physics is lattice QCD. You put QCD on a lattice and you do a computation and you get the results. And if QCD is a correct theory, and if our computational algorithms are very good, of course, it will reproduce all the results. But then, it is as good or as bad as doing an experiment. It only confirms that QCD is correct. It may not necessarily tell me what exactly is happening, which is the reason why we do an effective field theory. So we do effective field theories in high energy physics, but even more at home example is effective field theory that we always employ. Nobody employs Lorentz force to understand or Coulomb interaction to understand the interaction between two molecules. We employ van der Waal interactions, for example. Of course, when necessary, we know how to get van der Waals interaction starting from let us say the basic Coulomb interaction. We do a second order perturbation theory in quantum mechanics, so on and so forth. So this effective theory actually gives us a picture. It gives us a vivid picture of what is happening. You know what the potential, effective potential is, you know what the depth is, you know what the range is. You can quickly estimate how many bound states can be there, et cetera, et cetera. So you may sacrifice a little bit of precision, but you gain, although you sacrifice precision, by the insight that you get. So there is this fantasy that probably we can try to achieve some such thing even in the case of laser plasma acceleration, because it's a really intriguing and a very rich phenomenon. So here, the theoretical tools are mostly PIC simulation. We had a number of talks, and I should say that they are heroic, the way people have worked to develop very precise codes and incorporating everything. Of course, even there, some compromises are made. For example, you don't do exactly PIC simulation. You also employ Vlasov equations, where you are going to already an effective picture, fluid dynamics. But I would still say it is a sort of brute force, bottom-up approach. So what we are going to ask is, since all our simulation friends tell us that they are able to get an excellent agreement, in fact, if you look up the papers, they do a simulation and show a beautiful agreement, is everything under control? But the nagging feeling still persists, what exactly we have understood, because can a simulation be adequate to understand the physics? So to give you an idea, for example, the laser beam energy could be of the order of 5 electron volt, plasma temperature is of the order of 50 electron volt, and the electron beam energy is of the order of 100 MeV over a distance of 3 millimeter. So is it possible to think of physics behind such a massive field gradient, and how do we incorporate the collective features of the plasma? That is the most important thing. So one of the interesting things that the PIC simulation people were saying was that they don't have to worry about radiation because they are calculating the fields completely. So at the end of the day, what they do is to project out the transverse part and get the radiation. Whereas conventionally in an electrodynamics course, I would put a Leonard V-shot potentials and ask what is the radiation which is coming by going to the radiation zone. So it is not that PIC misses physics, but PIC probably may not tell you what physics I should look for unless I know that I look for radiation. So we want to develop a complementary approach. So what we would like to do is to incorporate the collective features of the plasma from the very beginning. So what we need is effective degrees of freedom, which I have to fill up, collective features that underlie plasma that I have to fill up. And the idea is that we try a repeat of what Maxwell did. Maxwell not only gave us equations in free space, which we celebrate quite a lot, but he also gave the constitutive equations. He gave us the permittivity and the permeability, and he did a large number of experiments to determine them. And constitutive equations give us a lot of insight. So what we want to do is to try and repeat what Maxwell did in this context. So that is what we wish to do. What we hope to understand is describe the physics behind collimation, monochromaticity, and the large yield by incorporating the collective features. And the clue, as I told you, is the dielectric permittivity of the plasma. Okay. So now the technical part starts. I have 38 minutes. Okay. So first, what we do is to write down the Maxwell's equations, the equations in the Fourier space. So what I have done is to write it in the Fourier space. So you have the Coulomb law here, and you have the Ampere law here. So please notice, I have introduced the longitudinal permittivity and the transverse permittivity here. And this is the curl of B term. J is curl of B, and that is the delta E by delta T term. That is the reason why you have I omega. That is what I have. I am not going to write the other two Maxwell's equations because I am going to do all the calculations with my gauge potentials in some particular gauge. So I have the longitudinal projection operator, and they have the transverse projection operator, and these are my corresponding permittivities. So this is basically plasma physics 101 or whatever in Landau-Lifshitz volume 10, okay, physical kinetics. Okay. So the relevant scales are the plasma frequency, the debye length, the thermal velocity. There is a dimensional scale x with respect to which the permittivities are calculated, plotted, and I'm going to express all cross sections in the unit of the classical radius of the electron squared. Plasma physicists like to do that, so we also do that, which is 10 to the power of minus 24 centimeter squared, which we are all familiar with. So we start with the Lagrangian. So I have the Dirac Lagrangian because it is the electrons that are getting accelerated to relativistic speeds, relativistic energies. Then I have the field, and then I have the interaction energy. So the Dirac Lagrangian is the standard Dirac Lagrangian, psi bar, whatever that we write. The interaction is the standard minimal coupling. So the place where our Lagrangian or the interaction is non-trivial is in the field, because now my Lagrangian is not simply E squared minus B squared, but it is E dot D, both the transverse part and the longitudinal part with the corresponding, I need not have written the L there, with the corresponding projection operators that are put there. And just to remember that the D field and the E field are related through the Fourier transform. And they're in the Fourier space, of course, they are the products. So all the physics that I'm going to discuss is driven by these permittivities. I should warn you that it is an incomplete analysis. We have left out a lot of things, even at the formulation level, but I will mention that later. Okay. So now I have to set up the Hamiltonian. So we did not know that this has already been done. So we spent some time setting up the Hamiltonian. It is not simply going to be E squared plus B squared. You can see there are these complicated derivative terms, delta of omega squared epsilon t by delta omega, etc., with the corresponding projection operators operating on EI and DJ. This is not a magnetized plasma. The magnetic field part is not of any interest to us. In any case, I think I have just made use of the fact that curly is delta B by delta T, and I have observed that. Now, in the spirit of field theory, I want to look upon this Hamiltonian as coming from a collection of oscillators. That is how we are going to quantize that. So I want to introduce my annihilation operator and the creation operator, which requires a little bit more of work because I have to fix the normalization factors. So we fix the normalization factors, and once we do that, all these are important when we calculate the cross sections. They are not non-trivial, they are not trivial terms. So you do the exercise and then you do the quantization of the field. The thing was that all this is found in the book of Harris, I think, but we did not know. So we worked it out and then it was pointed out. In fact, we were kind of, who is that person? Daniel Defoe's book, Robinson Crusoe. We were not even aware of the Bohm-Gross relation. So then somebody pointed out, this is the Bohm-Gross relation. Why did you rederive that? But it doesn't matter. It was fun. Yeah, that is what we have improved upon it later. We have improved upon it slightly, but not too much. Yeah. So you can now see that because of the medium, there are a number of modifications from the free space. A new mode is introduced, which is my longitudinal mode. And then there is a whose dispersion relation is epsilon L equal to zero. And of course, there is a transverse mode whose dispersion relation is also again changed. In free space, epsilon t would be equal to 1, and we will write omega squared equal to k squared. I have put c equal to 1. But and this would not exist at all. So there is a small aside regarding these notations. For us, everything is a photon here, whereas in conventional plasma physics or maybe condensed matter, the longitudinal mode would be the plasmon, and this would be called as the photons. But for us, everything is a photon because the photon acquires a mass in the medium. So many of us who work in this field probably would benefit a lot if we read that classic paper of Anderson in 1963, where he actually discusses the Higgs phenomenon. See, this is a medium, everything is fine, photon acquires a mass, but gauge invariance is not broken. So that's quite a nice paper, okay. That's right. No, this also is modified. Correct. All the plasma properties are in the permittivity. Yeah, because the electromagnetic properties of the medium are completely contained in that complete information is in the permittivity of the medium. The challenge is to determine the permittivity of medium as well as possible, like in any other system. So the form that we used are Bohm-Gross improved by Fried-Conte tabulation. We could not go beyond that, but that was rich enough. So here we have plotted the dispersion relation. So one of them is, the left one is longitudinal and the right one is transverse. So what I want you to notice, everything is dimensionless, divided by omega p, the plasma frequency. So please notice that there is quite a drastic difference, not along the y-axis, but along the x-axis. K takes values 20, 40, 60, whereas there it is going from 0 to 1. So that is something that we can keep in mind. Now, when I do the calculation before I start, there is one more thing that I would like to point out. I am using a relativistic notation purely out of laziness. So I am employing the Greek index mu for both energy and momentum. Mu equal to 0 stands for energy, mu equal to 1, 2, 3 will stand for momenta. So I have to conserve the momentum, but then the dispersion relations have changed. And this is a collective notation for many, many transitions that are taking place. For example, a plasmon can become a plasmon, photon can go to a photon, photon can go to a plasmon can go to a photon in my scattering process. That is what I would like to do. And in each case, since the dispersion relation has changed, the available phase space after the calculation. So we are looking at kinematics. We are not still looking at dynamics. This is quite independent of why I'm going to do the calculation. Because of the modified dispersion relations, what one can observe is that the phase space can get severely restricted. So we get a hint of why there is a nice collimation. That is what I would like to point out. Okay. Now I set up the Feynman rules. So electron, since I have written a standard Dirac electron, that is not going to change. I did not modify my electron-photon vertex. But here, you can see that both the transverse and the longitudinal photons have acquired a mass. So there are this mass factor delta LT squared, which comes as a complicated function of epsilon. We don't have to worry about that. So the basic Compton scattering that I'm going to do, which involves everything, what people call resonant Raman scattering and the standard Compton scattering, all of it is contained in these Feynman diagrams. So these are my Feynman diagrams. There are not just two, but many of them. Because as I told you, the initial... I have put the wrong diagram. I'm really sorry about that. I have put in the pair production diagram because I made a mistake. I should be writing the Compton scattering diagram. But the initial photon can either be a plasmon or a... Yeah, that is true. That is true, but as you said, we are always used to going up in time. Okay. Now, see, that these are the figures which I would like you people to please pay attention to for a few minutes. This is the momentum transfer that takes place. I am computing a tree-level diagram. This is the momentum transfer that takes place between the various modes. So this is the plasmon going to the plasmon. This is the TL. This is the LT, and this is the corresponding this one. So this is what we are interested in, and we see that in these two cases, there is a positive momentum transfer that is taking place. And the scales are quite large. Here you are speaking of 0.05 or 0.1, but there the scale is of the order of about 5. I suppose it is in the units of electron volts or whatever. It's a very, very small nudge that it is getting because we are performing a single scattering. Okay, here comes the important expression. We do a calculation of Compton scattering at the tree level. Okay. Now this tree level is a mysterious word, but actually a tree level calculation is a classical calculation. There is no quantum mechanics in it. So in principle, one could have done a classical field theory calculation. Like you know, we do Rayleigh scattering or whatever classically, except that it becomes very cumbersome in the classical notation. Here, a whole lot of diagrams, which I'll have to write in a classical field theory, become unified. So although this has a flavor of quantum mechanical calculation, it is not a quantum mechanical result. Like Rutherford scattering, which we do in quantum mechanics, is not quantum mechanical. It is the same classical result that we are going to get. So it is an effective field theory, and at this state, it is not an effective quantum field theory. That will be playing a role only when I switch on the quantum effects. So we are not doing that. So it is classical. So now let us look at the Klein-Nishina formula. So people who are in high energy physics, they recognize that this famous x by y plus y by x minus 2, this is the famous Klein-Nishina formula. Now we are getting a whole lot of corrections to that. And these are three terms which I have highlighted here. I am not going to display those expressions. I mean, they are all boring, long expressions. But these are the most important contributions to my scattering probability, okay? Klein-Nishina contribution is a minuscule contribution, a very, very small fraction, orders of magnitude smaller than that. So what we are going to do is to concentrate on the contribution coming from this, and we are going to look at the cross-section. So this is my effective field theory. So I do a calculation. Maybe I should have put in one more transparency, but I have only 26 minutes time, so it's okay. So the medium is playing two roles for me. No. Maybe I should take more questions actually. So the medium is playing two roles in my calculation. The effect of the medium is in the collective mode of a plasma. After all, how do I distinguish an ideal gas from a plasma? Because of its interaction, because of its correlation, which I have incorporated, although very feebly, in my permittivity. And the other role that the medium plays is that once the scattering takes place, I have to do a thermal average. Because, so the medium has two roles to play. And this has quite an interesting history. Apparently, the great Chandrasekhar, I think there is a room named in his honor here, he advised Edmonds to do a calculation of a very similar kind to find out if the energy can increase sometime in 1950s. So Edmonds' calculation actually did not incorporate the permittivity, the collective, the medium nature, but he certainly did a thermal average and he argued that there can be a blue shift in the electron energy. So these calculations were done. And occasionally there could be a blue shift in the Compton energy also. So that was on the advice of Chandrasekhar. Probably he had great interest because of his astrophysics. So what we are doing here is to look at the medium in both its phases, in both its roles, one as a medium that modifies the radiation properties through the permittivity, all the medium effects are taken into it, taken account, and the other through is the thermal average. And when you do the thermal average and you plot d sigma by d omega, so you see something which is quite remarkable here, and probably I should spend some time. So let us look at the plasmon going to plasmon, which in the classical language you would say, there is this field that is produced, the plasmon field, there is a very strong electric gradient, and the electron accelerates in that strong field. So this is the cross section coming from that, and you see, as a function of 0 to 2 whatever radians, 2 is an extrapolation, I mean, pi is what we need. What we are finding is that there is an evidence already for an excellent collimation. So it is getting collimated at some point. It is of the order of 10 to the power of 13. These cross sections are not large, by the way. In absolute numbers, probably it is of the order of 10 to the power of 5 or 10 to the power of 6 or some such thing. So the cross section is uniformly large, but you find a very nice peak here. Here, the photon is getting scattered into a plasmon due to the longitudinal mode. Again, you find a very nice evidence for collimation. In fact, this is when we saw this, that the bell rang in our mind that, oh, there is something called laser plasma accelerator, and we went back and did a lot of calculations. On the other hand, if you look at the plasmon going to the longitudinal mode, what is 10 to the power of 13 or 10 to the power of 11, all these are in the units of classical electron radius, becomes 1500. These are absolute numbers. And look at my standard Compton scattering, it is of the order 4. It's a small correction to the Klein-Nishina formula. And this shows a really bad behavior. I mean, there is nothing that you can learn from this. Whereas here, there is an excellent collimation. Allowed phase space. The phase space, because first of all, the longitudinal mode does not exist in free space. And the dispersion relations tells you epsilon L equal to 0. So that dispersion relation has to be, my momentum conservation has to be consistent with the dispersion relation. Initially, my momentum energy relation is written through this dispersion relation. My final energy momentum is written through this dispersion relation, and I'm conserving energy and momentum, and that is responsible for this. Now, there is a question about why these cross sections are very, very large, and that is because, you know, if you do the standard just Bohm gross, there is this omega minus k dot v when the phase velocity approaches. So we are basically hitting that resonance, and the cross section is blowing up, which is not available in the case of the transverse to transverse mode. So from a very simple linear permeability, we are able to see this.
Your permittivism includes temperature effects?
This is all at a given temperature, yeah.
What is the temperature, for instance, in the first curve?
No, all these are actually done with realistic plasma parameters, whatever the experimental is used. I think it is of the order of 50 MeV, I showed the number, no? The incoming beam is of the order of 4 MeV, electron volt, not MeV, I'm very sorry about that, electron volts. So we have used even the densities, the plasma density is whatever the experimental is used. Very, very close to that. So So these are not done in with any other number. They are not just of academic, this one. Okay. So this is what we find. This is 10 to the power of 13. Huh. Yeah, yeah, yeah. All of them are in the same units. So I am speaking of 4 and 10 to the power of 11 here. Yeah. Which one? This one, no? No, these are the large numbers, right? See, please notice this number, 10 to the power of 13, 10 to the power of 11. Here it is only 4. Oh, that is what I am trying to focus. Actually, these numbers are incredible and it is very difficult to believe them. So I am not asking you to believe them. Is that okay? Because, yeah, yeah, I am not joking. In fact, we had great difficulty in getting accepted, except that this paper went in plasma physics to a Russian referee. I should certainly say that, who actually sat down and did this calculation. He said that he has verified. And he gave us a lot of references from the old Russian school, from Akhisar Beristetsky, Davidov, all these books. He did not, of course, do a complete calculation, but he did a large number of, he probably did some order of magnitude estimates, did the thing, and he said that these are not unbelievable. Okay. So that is something that I would like to point out. In a real calculation, it may not be 10 to the power of 11, it may go down if I put in more realistic parameters. So the message that I want you to take is not so very much about the numbers. Maybe it is 10 to the power of 7. When I do a more careful calculation, the fact is that there is a great, great enhancement. There is a great magnification which has come from a field theory calculation. This was quite painful for us to do these computations. But after I heard the PIC talks, this is child's play for them, the kind of computation that we did, okay? So that is something that I should say, okay? So now we have to worry about the energy distributions. I showed the angular distribution. So now we look at the d sigma by d as a function of energy. Again, you see that as a function of energy, that there is a reasonably very good collimation here. So this green line is the cumulative yield. That is, you integrate the yield until that point extend you point that. So you see that there is almost no yield here at all. It starts increasing. There is a step function because of this very large number in this very, very small region. Again, there is a step function. Again, there is an yield. And there are some small peaks and it goes up. So this picture is telling me that not only is there a collimation, that is what we see here as a function of theta, but there is also a corresponding monochromaticity in the beam. So both of which we are able to see, and these are the essential features of laser plasma acceleration. Of course, there is a great difference if you look at the absolute values of energy. Theta is fine. We are speaking of electron volts. You see that, right? We are speaking of something like 60 electron volt or 80 electron volts. But in a real laser plasma accelerator, we are speaking of 100 MeV. So there is nothing much that is happening. In fact, the thermal velocity is already 50 electron volt. So if I am speaking of something 80 electron volt, that is not any great number that I am looking at the acceleration. But still, I would invite you people to sort of look at this and compare it with the experimental number. And you see that there is a semblance of the monochromaticity and the theta scattering that is taking place. So probably, if I can improve upon this and if I can do a more careful calculation and study the features in greater detail, I may be able to come closer to this experimental curve. So that is the whole idea. That is quite true. That is why I said we should not take those very large magnifications very seriously. Yeah, I will show some more curves. And probably, see. Yeah. No, no, certainly not. Probably, what I would like to say is that here is an approach which tells you that it is possible. We should certainly not be trying to compare it with experimental numbers or anything. Linearity is delivering this too much. After all, I am sending in a photon of a given this one, whereas where we said that pulse shaping is an extraordinarily important thing. But if we incorporate that, probably the very large magnification will come down. Probably I will get an even better figure, but the message that I want to send is that this kind of an approach, if I incorporate nonlinear dispersion relations, etc., may be still able to deliver, and it will give me an intuitive picture of what kind of a scattering is taking place. And it might provide insight which is complementary to the precise information and the precision of the PIC. That is what I want to say. It would be very stupid of me to say that we have understood or even partially understood laser plasma acceleration. This is just the beginning of the calculation. As I said, you know, we were not even looking at laser plasma acceleration. We were looking at Compton. But even the linear regime is showing a fairly promising future for this kind of an approach. In fact, there are a number of things that we have overlooked. In fact, I'm going to make a big list of that. And the hope is that we are going to take that up at some this one. I mean, probably this kind of a program should run in parallel. That is what I hope. No, that can be incorporated. That can be incorporated into this. It will still be a Compton scattering. No, that can be incorporated. No, that is what I am saying. You can incorporate the beam, because beam is external, no? All that I have to do is to give an energy. Huh? Not the electron beam. What is incoming is the laser beam, the photon. So I can give the right energy distribution and I can incorporate that. But before I run into doing any such thing, you see, there is no point in putting everything if I don't know that it is going to deliver something. I have to do some kind of a toy calculation. So this should be looked upon as probably even a precursor to a toy calculation. But if it's going to deliver, then I'm now in a position to put the laser plasma, the pulse shape. I should be able to put the nonlinearity. There is one more thing which I have overlooked, and that is, we are looking at how the properties of the radiation change because of the medium. We also have to worry about how the properties of the electron change because of the very strong field. I cannot look at the free solutions of the Dirac. I am writing the asymptotic free states, no? There is something called a Volkov equation which I should put in. But then, why should I do all that if there is no hope or if there is no possibility of getting anything at all? So, what I am worried about is that there is a possibility of a certain enhancement of the cross-section, collimation, of monochromaticity. Those numbers are not to be taken seriously, those angles are not to be taken seriously. So if that is delivered, then one can actually initiate a program and look at that. And we can try to see whether we can get, because this is a kind of, as I said many times, it's complementary. It is not precise, but it will, effective approaches always give us a picture of what is happening. Because I am writing a Lagrangian, I am saying there is a permittivity, etc., etc. One should be able to do that. So the limitation is not at the level of formulation, but in the sophistication. And that is not a very, very big limitation. If that is what I hope, okay, if we can apply our mind. Okay. Okay. So please take all the results in this spirit. Is that okay? So now I would be interested in calculating the mean force on the electron after thermal average. Because what have I done? I have done a single scattering. Okay, and I am saying that the energy increased by 5 electron volt or 10 electron volt or anything. Whereas in something like PIC, that is a very good input, because immediately you compute what the accelerating field gradient is. What is an input there comes as an output here. So what I do is to estimate the time over which the electron scatters. Of course, my electron is propagating as a virtual particle, because it has absorbed a photon. The propagator is there, electron propagator is there. So one very simple way of estimating is to make use of the uncertainty principle, delta m delta tau is of the order 1. And if you did that, you will get a number like something like 60 MeV per centimeter. So what this essentially demonstrates is that such fields are possible. So this is exactly the kind of number that a precise simulation is going to give. I would not have been very worried if it had turned out to be 10 MeV or 100 MeV, because I am not going to take that very seriously. But you certainly find that this kind of an accelerating gradient is possible. So one can actually say that probably it is not all that incredible. So let us take stock at this particular point. So even with a very, very simplified approach, quite simplified, we have been able to see collimation. You have got a monoenergetic beam. You get an acceleration. And once I know the scattering time, I can also estimate the scattering length, the length over which it has scattered. So you get a few nanometer. That is what you are going to get. So the question is, does this mean anything at all? One thing that I can do in the same spirit is to simply say that, okay, the acceleration took place over a centimeter, this is a few nanometer. So if you assume that the same thing happens, let us say 10 to the power of 7 times, is that okay? It keeps going. I will multiply everything by the same factor, and you can easily see that what is a few electron volt will become tons of MeV, very close to 100 MeV, because I am multiplying by 10 to the power of 7. So that is some kind of a fantastic thing. It may be credible, it may not be credible. So what we can try to do is something slightly better than that, which Ravindra did with great painstaking effort. The first thing that we did was, people know that plasma acceleration is very, very sensitive to parameters, to the density, etc., etc. So we wanted to check if our calculations will give you the same thing at all energies, at all the temperatures, or, you know, then it is of no use again. It is some artifact which will vanish. So here is a plot for three temperatures, 30 electron volt, 50 electron volt, 70 electron volt. That is what we have. And this is a figure, for example, which shows you the accelerating gradient. Again, I think I goofed up. There is a thing called beam quality index, which we introduced. So the beam quality basically it says, you know, how good the collimation should be, how monochromatic it should be, what should the yield be, etc., etc. You see that it is quite sensitive. It can be quite small, it can be quite large. So there is a promise for that. We have a number of figures like this in our physics of plasma paper, including the beam quality index. So that actually is because the density is occurring both in the permittivity and also in the average. And it is not appearing in a linear fashion, it appears in a very complicated way. So it is very, very difficult to sort of pinpoint and say, okay, maybe we have not done careful enough analysis as to where it should be a peak and where it should be a valley. But certainly we find that there is this kind of a sensitivity to this one. Okay. So this is actually probably the last of my slides. So this is a summary of very hard work done by Ravindra. So what Ravindra argued was that in PIC, what do? You divide the phase space into a large number of cells and you drive it. So imagine every single Compton scattering to be the equivalent of a small cell in a PIC, in a phase space. That is what is happening. So if I did a single Compton scattering, by Compton I mean including everything, why should I not do multiple scattering? But the complication here is that every time, not only do I do a calculation, I have to do a thermal average because my electron is sitting there. So Ravindra got this great idea that he is not going to do a cross-section like he did for the first time. He will identify those electrons which were coming in that angle, in the narrow angular region, in the narrow energy region, and he will follow them. And there were two contributions. One was plasmon to plasmon, another was photon to plasmon. He followed them and he looked at the collimation angle, whether collimation will persist through multiple scatterings and whether monoenergeticity will persist through multiple scatterings or not. So this is one of the figures which showed us the best figures, so best yields, that is what I'm showing. So you can see he did about 10 to the power of 6 scatterings. He wrote a program and he did 10 to the power of 6 scatterings. So the program runs through and chunks the Compton scattering and it follows only the path of that. You can see that there is a very beautiful collimation, that there is a quite monoenergeticity, and the collimation angle is sort of getting saturated. And in terms of numbers, the energy is of the order of 110 MeV. The monochromaticity is in delta E by E, which is 0.64%. And the angular spread is about 4 milliradian. And the question is, how much of the total cross-section is sitting in this particular peak? We are interested in knowing. That is about 58% of the contribution. Again, please don't take these numbers very seriously. Please only take them as some kind of indicators of the promise that this kind of an approach holds. After all, in high energy physics, we are used to doing many, many effective field theories. And in spite of QCD being a fundamental theory, probably we should not be reliant on lattice gauge theory. So here also, it is good to approach R like chemists do. So this is the kind of number that we are going to get. So here is the summary, drawback, and outlook. In principle, collimation and monochromaticity, accelerating gradient. It is adaptable to all kinds of laser plasma. No, this is an important thing. There is pair production, for example. There is one plasma accelerator where you send electron beams from both the directions. And there is a pair production. Pair production is very, very easily incorporated in my effective field theory approach, because all that I have to do is to write the correct diagram. Quantum corrections can be computed. So we in high energy physics always remember the great quantum correction of Schwinger to synchrotron radiation. He did it in 1940s, which actually is quite important. So here it is actually going beyond the classical calculation. But then this analysis is incomplete. In fact, it has barely begun. We have ignored nonlinear dispersion relation. We have ignored pulse shaping. We have ignored Volkov equations. Volkov wrote it, I don't know, probably soon after Dirac wrote his equation. For example, if there were a very strong magnetic field, I should be doing my field theory with Landau levels, because the electrons go and sit in Landau levels. I cannot use free states. So here I should use Volkov equations in the presence of a very strong electromagnetic field. We have to incorporate that. So if there is any sense in what we are doing, so probably this is the right time to embark on this. So to conclude, physics is beautiful at all levels. And you know, it seems somebody asked Chandrasekhar, or Chandrasekhar quotes, I mean, how should a sculpture be admired, from a close by or from a distance? And he was advised that because a great piece of music or a great piece of sculpture should be admired from all distances and from all angles. Is that okay? So if I can be a little bit wacky and make a statement, laser plasma accelerators, like what Blake said, hold infinity in the palm of your hand. Because compared to these huge beasts, you know, Rakshasas, the gigantic sun machines, here is a tabletop machine. And if our idea is very wild, probably effective field theory is heaven in a wildflower. So this is our homage to William Blake. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So I finished in time.
Sure. Not traditional approach.
There is no magnetic field here. I don't know the answer. I know how to do it, but I don't know the answer. So that depends on the strength of the magnetic field. If it is very strong, then I will populate the electrons in the Landau levels if I'm doing quantum mechanically. Classically, I would put them in cyclotron orbits and then ask how they are going to scatter. Classically, it would be a cyclotron orbit. Quantum mechanically, it would be a Landau level. And classically it is degenerate, quantum mechanically also it is degenerate, so that is how I would do the calculation. Here the magnetic part is...
The kind of magnetic field that we involved are much
more... Yeah, right, so right.
Quantum effect may not be important.
Yeah. So even here there is a role of spin, but we have spin averaged, because nobody is looking at the spin. People are only asking how many electrons can I collect. So we have averaged over the spin, yeah. So there is a pair production, for example. However, it is not easy to incorporate in the calculation because it is purely classical. In fact, you have to bring in QED very, very complicated way. That is what I was learning from what people were saying. Whereas this is a very natural language. And in fact, this fits in the whole phenomenon of laser plasma interaction in the broad canvas, you know, of physics in strong fields. There are a lot of other interesting things, no? You can find a very strong electric field in a cavity and people see spontaneous pair production, for example. Eventually, so this fits into that and we get a unified understanding. Effective field theories will never give you the precision, but they will give you a picture. For example, I am able to argue, you know, why there is a collimation. I am able to argue, for example, why there is a this one. It might emerge from there also, but I don't see any harm. But certainly if you want to compute quantum corrections, this is the best, because this is a natural language.
More useful for other quantum effects rather than the electron acceleration?
No, even here people are already seeing, right. Actually the title, my original title was laser plasma interaction at high fields. But since the theme here is acceleration and we are also studying acceleration, yeah. Yeah.
Not included. For example, the wave that we put in the plasma,
yeah,
does not produce a monochromatic plasma.
Yeah, yeah, correct, correct. I said that, no? Yeah.
Whole spectrum of
yeah, yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
When we put a whole spectrum of waves, what will happen to the collimation? What will happen to the energy?
No, that is what I believe. The one thing, one realization that I have now is that I cannot do things piecemeal anymore. If I put in the complicated whatever the spectrum of this one, I better put in nonlinear dispersion relations, I better put in Volkov equations, then I have enough of confidence to believe that it will give me, it may not give me very precise answers, but it will certainly show some kind of mechanism behind the laser plasma acceleration.
How do you take account of nonlinear effects like trapping and acceleration?
No, nonlinear dispersion relations, which what I can put. Beyond that, I do not know. I would have to discuss with you. Because my physics of plasma physics is not great. I mean, I have picked it up as I went along through, you know, volume 10 of Landau-Lifshitz or whatever. So, but probably as we keep talking more and more, well, it should be, I mean, yeah. And it comes from the other direction, coagulant plasma, where frankly speaking, we don't really speak of all these things. So.
Did you have finite lifetime for the light wave?
No, we are sending a single photon and we are simply looking at the scattering.
And then for how much time is it? Like you say, it goes up to this much energy.
Yeah.
Is it all the way up to infinity in time?
No, the S band, no, no, no. I gave you a time, no, delta M, delta tau when you estimate. The scattering distance is, we'd say, over a distance of a nanometer. And the corresponding time will be essentially like, you know, that distance divided by the speed of light. It will be a very, very small number, maybe 10 to the power of minus 9 seconds, 10 seconds of that order. So that is the time over which the energy is absorbed and the electron is getting a kick. I didn't estimate time, I was more interested in the length, but we can get that. You can take it to be, at that energy, you can still take it to be close to the speed of light, let us say. It would be an exaggeration. So that is what you would get.
Yeah, it is sort of the distance divided by the group.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. What fiber?
Optical fiber. Can this collimation can be treated like a channel? No.
Channel is the language. I don't know. See, here there is no language of a channel.
Okay.
That is the whole thing. There is a channel because all the electrons like to come about in that direction. Is that okay? And I am saying that that is because of the tight bond put by the dispersion relations. If you want to conserve both energy and momentum, it has no option but to go in that direction. So, I mean, we need some kind of a dictionary and we need some kind of a, you know, translation to go from one to the other. That is exactly the point. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So, yeah. Because if you look at that perspective, then the dispersion relation in your, like in your electromagnet, people in the waveguides they use, like you'll have a cutoff frequency and things like this can be shown
in that. I don't know about that. Maybe we can talk about that, yeah.
The second question is the in the whole regime, the charge conservation and other things, because plasma, like you will treat it as a quasi-charged, whatever, then is it, one looks at the charge conservation?
Charge is conserved. It is too sacred for us. Don't you worry about that. We'll never get, that is automatically inbuilt. There is no problem about that at all. Our whole life begins with these things, I mean, conservations.
That's all.
Thank you very much.
So, lunchtime, thank you.